Good morning. Today's reading can be found in the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 through 5. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran. And they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. Well, we've arrived finally at the third week in our Seven Realities series. This week, I guess, we'll be halfway. It's seven. Three is just a little short of that, but you'll be beginning to study in just a week's time, the fourth lesson, of course, in the series. We hope you've gotten a lot out of it already, not just from the messages, but certainly from the study groups that you're in, but also those of you who are doing the study as individuals or with your family. There is a lot of meat in both the Old and New Testament references in this wonderful Blackaby series. There's also the DVD, and I know a number of you in groups are watching those short segments to begin your time of study. We hope you're getting a lot out of those too, and hope you can tell already just in the first two that you may have seen how much fun we had creating those for you. There's another video, though, for the purposes of this morning that I would like to share with you, and just a little bit of a preface. How many of you have seen the new TV series called God Friended Me? Have you seen an episode or two? I've seen an episode and part of another, really the end of another. And those of you who've seen it, you know this, but it features a pastor's son, a grown man, a young African-American man whose father is an Episcopalian priest or pastor. And this young man has thrown off the faith of his father. And he is not a believer when the curtain opens, if you will, on this story, in this series of stories. All of a sudden, though, he gets on his phone a note that God, or someone purporting to be God, has friended him. Now, he does not believe it's really God, but part of him still wants to believe it. And just as the Blackaby series teaches us, God is trying to move us into the mainstream of the work that he's doing. God, as he friends this young man, moves him into the mainstream of the work that he's doing in that community. Issues get resolved remarkably. Even lives get saved. And this young man, increasingly, I think, is more faithful to answering the invitation of God, even though he still suspects. See what you think as you watch this.
New York City, home to 8.6 million people. Everyone's searching for meaning and answers.
There is no proof of God anywhere in the universe. We will debate that and more on today's episode of The Millennial Prophet. I am your host, Miles Finer, reminding you that there is no God and that is okay.
Per usual, you're misinformed.
You grew up in the church, you know this better than anyone.
Yes, it is true. My father's a reverend. We got the whole Luke Vader dynamic going on.
I thought I had it all figured out, but then something happened and it changed my life forever.
I got a friend request from God.
What?
Holy.
Hey!
kids. You come around here again, I'll call the police.
Who's John Doe?
Whoa, whoa.
I am so sorry.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I think you just saved my life. Thank you.
If this series does nothing else than get us thinking about how God might also be inviting us to participate in his really life-saving work, then I think it served its purpose today. I don't know where the series is going to end up. I have hopes and prayers where I think it might, but just in the first few episodes, it does just get us thinking about the study that we're doing and how God is always working and how God wants to use people like you and me to fulfill his purposes. The first 2 week sessions, God is always at work. It was as simple and as sophisticated as that. And then the second week, God pursues a loving relationship with you that is continuing and profoundly personal. Now God invites you and me to be involved in the work that he is already in the midst of doing. You already know this, but Henry Blackaby highlights it in the series for us this week. God is the sovereign ruler of all that he's created, all the areas and aspects of the universe. He is all-powerful. You know that's one of his attributes. And yet, amazingly, really miraculously, it seems to please him to use people like Abraham and Moses and Hannah and Deborah and people like you and me in the work that he's doing in this world. He blesses us, just as Paula read a few moments ago in the text, always to be a blessing. And to be a blessing not just to some people, but to all people that God puts in our path. As it was with Abraham, meaning your whole world, not just your family or your inner circle, not just your close community, not just your class, your clique, your race, your creed, but anyone that God puts in proximity to us. He wants us to be a blessing as he works through us in reconciling the world to himself. Now, we're going to talk a little bit more about the call of Moses because he's the featured Old Testament character in the Blackaby study, but we'll also, in the last part of this message, get at the call of Abraham, the text that was read this morning. But we are called, we are blessed to be a blessing. And I've had a hard time until recently getting my mind, but also my heart around that. Not just the fact that it's an awesome thing to consider, but the rare privilege that it is, that the way God uses us to be merciful, to be grace-filled and kind and compassionate, forgiving, to show forth all those attributes of the very nature of Christ with the Spirit in us, in those ways and in others, he wants us to bless and to touch and to change the lives of other people. Now, those of you who've gone through these first couple weeks of studies in this seven-week series, you've already noticed that there's a little paragraph at the very end of each unit, of each chapter, and it's got kind of a summary of the high points that Henry Blackaby wants to have us hit to focus on in each week's lesson. Now, I've found it helpful to, before I begin to study the series, the week's lesson itself, to read that and even lift up one sentence or one phrase at a time. As I go through the daily studies, day by day, I think there are five for each week, and then certainly as I share with groups when I do the study itself. The one for this week, the short paragraph under the heading Wrap Up, is when God reveals to you where He's working, that's His invitation for us to join Him in that His activity. The revelation is the invitation. Love that part. If He's made something known to you, it's time to respond. And you see in that video you just watched, an urgent response was required. Nothing else. Let's take that first part, that first phrase. When God reveals to you where He's working, that's the invitation for us to join Him in His activity. Our study materials also say that our sovereign God does not need us to cast His visions for us. He doesn't need us to dream His fantastic, miraculous dreams of reconciling the world to Himself, of recreating it even after He has saved it and saved us. He doesn't need you and I to just simply do our best to fulfill His will, to do His will, and hope and pray that it will be good enough. This God doesn't just encourage us to be goal setters. And depending on who you listen to, what pastor or evangelist on satellite TV, a number of them, a couple of very famous ones, are goal setters. They come up and they put up on their screen a bunch of things in sequence, and they want them to be, they're recommending for them to be your specific goals in your life of discipleship. Not that that's not important, but that, in this series at least, is not what Blackaby believes Scripture is getting at in his invitation, certainly, to some prominent people in the Old Testament. And Blackaby insists, as it's recorded in Scripture many places, that God has already this cosmic agenda and this microcosmic agenda that sometimes we are just called into the midst of. It's already happening, and He's going to use someone, and hopefully you and I, to work out His will within those agendas, the grand and the more personal and intimate. God, in His infinite wisdom, as Blackaby puts it in this chapter, had the plan before the dawn of time. Now, we know this through several of the Psalms of David, and that's what he's referencing here. But he's reminding us that you and I, too, are an important part of His creation. You and I have, then, by necessity, a role to play in the larger, grand scheme of things and in the closer-to-home relationships. You ask right away, the first page or two, the first day or two in this study, you know, what is that specific work that God has in mind for us? It's not always as dramatic, certainly, as the couple events, crises that you saw in the video, but He has different rhythms in our lives of discipleship where He calls us to participate, and to participate in reconciling other people of this earth, His other children, and drawing them close to Christ. Psalm 67 says, "Bless us, Lord, so all nations will know Your work." And Galatians 3, a beautiful passage, teaches, "All who have faith are children of Abraham, and each one plays an important role that the blessing might come to the Gentiles." In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the passage, one of the two passages that Pastor Ron read for us in our call to confessional prayer, Paul says we are Christ's, ministers of reconciliation, his ambassadors, as if he's making his appeal through us to bring others into the fold, into the family of faith. Christ's mercy, his love, his grace, his forgiveness are all blessings that each one of us is called to share. The people that we encounter in this earthly life. You know well how we do this officially, institutionally, as a congregation. And you'll see some vivid visual images in a few moments of some of the ways that you've been invited to participate in the mainstream of the work that God is doing at Central College Church. We've seen you do this as a congregation, as individuals. We've seen that you do this as you relate to each other in the groups in which you serve. We've seen you do this before and after worship as you reach out to people, perhaps a new person, a face that you've never seen before, someone who is finding their way. We've watched you and at times helped you get them connected with some important ministry or group within the life of this church. there is a member of our church staff who recently has reached out to a family that has, in recent months, pulled away from the church family and not been active, not been coming. And they had a family member last week who slipped into a coma because of a brain infection. And they needed their church family like perhaps never before. And just over the weekend, miraculously, this man has pulled out of it and he's now communicating with his wife and with his son. As Blackaby says, the revelation is the invitation, and that family's need was revealed to that member of our church staff, and the response was made in a timely and personal and faithful way. You know, in Moses' experience with God, you know what his cosmic purpose, his monumental purpose was, and that was for God to use him as he led the Israelites out of their bondage in Egypt. That was his primary purpose. But God offered the invitation to Moses to play this active leading role in that plan. And on the day he offers it to him on the mountainside, as you know, Moses uses every lame excuse in the book to try to wiggle his way out of it, doesn't he? Even the fact that he says he is not well spoken. And the suggestion of using his brother Aaron as the spokesperson for the Israelites is made, but if you read through the rest of the story of Moses, time after time, it is God using Moses as the spokesperson for his people. And over again, he plays a leading role, not just in their deliverance, but in reconciling them in their disobedience to the God who's already delivered them and blessed them. Second phrase, the next phrase in Blackaby's paragraph summary of this unit is, if he's made something known to you, it's time to respond. A lot of mission and ministry opportunities have been made known to you. As I mentioned earlier, you'd see some of them again in visual form. We're grateful for those of you who have responded to participate in these ministries or missions, but also the many of you who have pledged your financial support, but also importantly, your prayers uplifting each of these ministries and missions. We can't do anything in church life without your prayers, without each thing being uplifted and undergirded in prayer. We have an inkling that there will be more children on this church campus after the first of the year. And you may hear their voices in the hallway, and just as God heard the voices of His children of Israel long ago, you may be called, you may be invited to help nurture some of those children, to help bring them to faith in this fellowship. And in advance, you may be not just warned, but encouraged and invited. In the book of Exodus chapter 3, where again we picture this scene where Moses is standing on the edge of that mountain, one of many, many times where we will read about and see this scene with Moses talking to God on the mountain. This is the first one. And Moses is watching the sheep of his father-in-law Jethro kind of munch their way up the mountainside. And he sees this bush with this flame of fire, and what draws him over to it is the fact that it's not burned up, it's not consumed. And God says, I've heard the cries of my people back in Egypt, and I've come down to deliver them, and I want to use you. Now you can ask the question, when Moses sees this incredible sight, when he hears this invitation of God, this isn't new to him. You think about why Moses is on that mountaintop to begin with. He's on the run for his life. He's a fugitive from Egypt. And he's a fugitive because he also heard their cries. And remember, he lashed out and he went to bat for an Israelite slave and killed the man who was beating him on a construction site. God knows all of this. He's already been putting this in Moses' heart in the time leading up to this. God knows it's already personal for Moses. They are Moses' people too. He also is a Hebrew, an Israelite. God knows already that Moses has a history and a personal stake in these, his children. Even though he rebuffs God and tries to turn him away, God knows if he persists, he can make Moses a bigger, better, more courageous, and effective servant of his, as long as God goes back into Egypt with him. And he promises to do just that, even as he promises to go with us and be with us in every mission, in every ministry, in every relationship he calls us into. This week's study has a marvelous section. I think it's day 5. I'm pretty sure it's the 5th day of reflection and study. And it's titled at the top, Now is the Acceptable Time. I love that title. Where in that section, Blackaby talks about what it would be like if people like Abraham and people like Moses successfully put God off when he offered the important invitations to them and their lives. And Blackaby talks about how delayed obedience is really a form of disobedience. And when I read that, I had to stop. I'd never thought of it in quite that way. And I confess the first thing I felt at that point was guilt, was incredible guilt for all the host of ways I can think of in my life, a long list of times where I put God off, where I said, God, I'm so busy, give me a little bit more time, or give me till tomorrow morning. And yet God is faithful. And he may have used somebody else in a number of those cases to fulfill his purposes, but time is of the essence when God offers his invitation. And sometimes people's lives are even in peril, in a moment where they might be receptive to the Spirit of Christ and faith and receiving Christ with faith as their Savior. That moment sometimes is not only precious, but it is sometimes fleeting as well. Opportunities which you have faced and which have come to you in maybe even recent days, maybe someone's family heartbreak, maybe a friend or a sister or brother in Christ, maybe a neighbor who does not have a faith, who's been through a divorce or is going through it, or death, or facing a worrisome surgery, or has a need for a prayer in private, which you might share with them, may have already shared with them. Maybe it's a hungry family, and consider that as you help us build this miracle mountain. When God asks us to intercede for someone, as Blackaby says, it may be critical for us to stop in our tracks and set aside something else that we're doing that is taking our time, and be obedient to that invitation to stop and be blessed, to be a blessing. As we move now for the last part of our time together to the text from Exodus chapter 12, it's a very, very famous scene with the call of another important patriarch from the Old Testament. Here in verse 1 from Exodus 12, we read again the famous lines of the Lord's invitation to Abraham. And notice not only the beautiful verses about the blessing, which are a part of this passage I've always cherished, but notice also the immediate response of obedience of this man Abram, who had so much to give up and so much to lose. The Lord had said to Abraham, "Leave your country, your people, your father's household, and go to the land which not I've already shown you. Go to the land that I will show you, that you've never seen before. And I will make you into a great nation and bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I also will curse, and all the peoples of the earth will be blessed through you." And so Abraham left as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abraham was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. Think about that much missed fact there at the end. He was not a young man with his whole life ahead of him, was he? By today's standard, he was not an old man at 75, and I'm speaking from the perspective of my age. It's all from where you're coming from, I guess, but he was in the latter stages, what as it appeared, of his earthly life. And when he heard these promises, unbelievable promises, he didn't protest like Moses did. He immediately had the faith that was reckoned to him as righteousness, and he set out with his family to the land which God would show him. You know, getting your mind and your heart around this incredible passage and promise contained in this invitation, I wondered if Abraham considered all those years ago, 400 or 500 years even before Moses, what this blessing would look like in the year of our Lord 2018. And on the week of World Communion Sunday, I looked up online just to get a better feel for how many people of the Christian faith, we are his heirs, we are the Gentiles that the Scripture speaks about. How many are there on earth today? Nearly 2.4 billion. And how many countries? That's about a third, a little more than a third of the world's population. How many countries do you think have a large number, a sizable number of Christians living in them? I guessed maybe 60, 65 countries. It's 192 or 193 people who have been blessed by the gift of faith, by God's moving in the lives of people, not just like Abraham and Moses, but people like us, like you and like me. This is a God who's given us the Great Commission. That's enough to go on and to try to accomplish. But he's also a God who gives us many more smaller and subtle invitations and charges. And I have no doubt that someone in this room today will soon receive a blessing because you too answered God's invitation.